family. Hope you all are doing well today. It is definitely great to see you. If you will, please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you for the time that we are able to come together as your family, Lord, and we are able to learn at your feet. Lord, I just want to thank you for the trials and the tribulations that you give to us, that we may learn to lean on you instead of ourselves in times of hardship. Lord, that we may come to turn to you first whenever there is trouble. Lord, I just ask that now you bless us with wisdom, that we may be able to look into your word and understand what it is that we need, that we can grow to be more like you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Last week, we looked at an event where Jesus healed two blind men just before he made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Today, I want to take a moment and look at an incident that happened with Jesus that he uses to teach his disciples. This opportunity came after the triumphant entry, which means that it would put it in the timeline of roughly a few days after healing the two men at Jericho. Jesus begins his last days of his public ministry, and this account usually is referred to as the cursing of the fig tree, and it's seen in both the book of Matthew and the book of Mark. Now, whenever we have a story, whenever we have an illustration, we have the knowledge that is imparted to us about something that happened with Jesus, and it's in multiple books. It is our responsibility to look into both books or all three books so that we could get the full story, because just like if three of us were standing there and we saw the same event, there would be three different accounts. And when you put all three of those accounts together, that is when we get the full picture of what happened. So when reading this, many people get confused as to what the interaction truly is about. And it's my hope that once we conclude for today, everyone has a better understanding of the cursing of the fig tree. Now, Mark tells of this as the days in Jerusalem before Jesus' arrest falls in chronological order. So Mark puts them in order of the events of when they happen. Whereas Matthew, although he tells the same events, he tends to group the events from the week by topic, not by how they fall event-wise. And they're not necessarily in order of when they occurred. Here, Matthew, if you read his account, he combines two events together in his telling of the passage, whereas Mark breaks them up, showing that Jesus cursed this fig tree on one day, and the disciples noticed the effect the next day. Now, this doesn't mean that one is right and one is wrong. It's from two different perspectives. Today, our verses will be in the book of Mark. We'll be reading from chapter 11, verses 20 to 24. Now, to give you some perspective, as I said, the count is broken into two parts. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read the first part. That way it can give you a little idea of what we're coming from. And then we'll read together the second part. The first part is just a little bit before our verses. And it comes where it says, "And on the morrow, when they were..." Actually, let me back up, because that tells of the actual event, but I want to give you more perspective. So I'm going to back up one more. So we're looking at, "And Jesus entered in Jerusalem and into the temple, and when he had looked around upon all the things, and now the eventide was come, he went out unto Bethany with the 12. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree far off, having leaves, he came, it haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, No man eat fruit unto thee hereafter, forever. And his disciples heard this. Now, once we read that, what followed is an account of Jesus driving corrupt merchants out of the temple grounds. And when the chief priests heard Jesus preaching and teaching, the priests and the scribes wanted to find a way to destroy Jesus because they feared him, because all the crowd heard his teachings and were astonished at what he was saying. And when the evening came, again, Jesus and the 12 went out of the city. That is where we'll start our verses. So if you haven't already, turn with me to Mark chapter 11. We'll be starting at verse 20. Mark 11, verse 20 says, "And in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed, is withered away. And Jesus answering saith unto them, Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. And when ye stand praying, forgive if ye have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you from your trespasses." Now, I read one extra verse there, and that verse is important as well, because it says when you pray, when you go to the Lord, if you have anything against anyone else, you should always forgive, for God has forgiven you. So Jesus and the disciples spent the night on Mount Olives, most likely on or near Bethany, which, to give you an idea of where that's at, it's about 2 miles east of Jerusalem. And on the day before, they passed a fig tree, which Jesus cursed because it had no figs. Now, there's some things that we know about Jesus. He was fully man and fully God. That means that he had the same needs that we do. Some people seem to forget about that. They only look at Jesus as the deity. They don't look at him as the man as well. But we know from his temptation in the desert after not eating, he was hungry. He was starving, ravenous, right? Also, we know that he needed rest. When he was on the boat underneath and the storm was raging, they had to go and wake him up. And they asked him, "Don't you even care that we're about to all perish?" Jesus had needs. So when he went to the fig tree, it was because he was hungry. Verse 20 says, "As they passed by in the morning, they discovered the tree is utterly ruined." Now Matthew says, the tree became withered at once. That's one of the things that people like to point out as an inconsistency. But I'm going to tell you right now, we're talking about a full-grown tree, one that had leaves and that could bear fruit, which means that if it took 24 hours to wither, that's still at once. That's not something that's normal. It's not something that happens. No tree just dies overnight. So whether it's at once, meaning they were expecting it to happen right before them, or it happened in 24 hours, it still happened. That is at once. Now, verse 21 identifies Peter as the disciple that brings the withered tree to Jesus' attention, saying, "Master, behold, the fig tree that thou cursed is withered away." Now, in our verses, it's just mentioned that Peter mentions it, that the tree is withered. But if you read in Matthew, in his description, The disciples not only notice it, but it says this, Matthew 21:20. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, how soon is the fig tree withered away? They're asking, how could this happen? What in the world could have done this? Now, mind you, Jesus had shown authority over many worldly things. They had witnessed miracles while being with Jesus. Yet they marveled at the fact that this tree was dead. Jesus had shown that he had authority over illness and injury. We know this because multiple times he healed people, like the blind men outside of Jericho. He cast out demons before them. He controlled nature when he calmed those rough waters that they woke him about. Not only that, but he was able to duplicate food and feed the masses on just a few loaves and fishes. He even showed his dominion over death by raising Lazarus from the grave. Yet the 12 disciples still seem to be surprised at the fact that this tree that Jesus had cursed had withered. Now, some people question, and this is where they go off, kind of off base a little bit, or off rails. They get distracted because some people question why Jesus would do this to the tree. Why would he look at this tree that bore no fruit, but yet it wasn't seasoned for bearing fruit yet, and curse it? I'm going to explain that part relatively quickly, only because it's not important to dwell on that part as much as it is to get to the part where Jesus is teaching. So, to explain the tree and why it was that Jesus cursed the tree, it's possible that Jesus destroys the tree as a symbol of the coming destruction of Israel. You see, remembering during the triumphant entry, we're told this about Jesus. As he drew near, he saw the city and he wept over it, saying, if you had known, even you, especially in your day, the things that make your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes, for days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surrounded you, and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave you in one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation. So when Jesus wept, it was because the people expected Jesus to bring peace through war. They didn't understand why he came to them. He came to bring them eternal peace, true peace. And that true peace was standing right in front of them, and they missed it. That true peace is standing before everyone in the world today, and yet so many people miss it. The people of that day didn't acknowledge Jesus as the King of all kings or the God of all gods. Instead, they simply viewed him as a human king who would lead them into victories against their oppressors. Jesus wept because he looked upon the city he loved and he knew future judgment was coming for them. In the Old Testament, it often compares Israel to a fig tree, associating the ruin of its fruits with God's judgment. Now, an example of this is in Jeremiah 8:13, where it says, I will surely consume them, saith the Lord. No grapes shall be on the vine, nor fig on the fig tree, and the leaf shall fade, and the things that I have given them shall pass away from them. This is God describing his judgment upon Israel. This warning comes, and it's strengthened by God's warning that he will sweep them away utterly, because Judah had become an unfruitful vine and a tree that bare no fruit. So when Jesus does this to the fig tree, when he withers the fig tree, this is an example of what's to come for those people who did not recognize him. Jesus knows that Israel and Judaism are no longer fruitful. They will reject him and kill him when they should welcome him as their Messiah. If Jesus' point is that Israel has lost its fruitfulness and will be destroyed. It's a message that perhaps the disciples themselves may not have been ready for. So instead, what Jesus does is he uses this moment to teach them a more basic skill, a skill that we all must learn. When I say basic, this is one of the foundations that we must stand upon. And this basic skill is what's going to get us through our trials and our tribulations. In verse 22 of our text, it says, and Jesus answering the question that they posed. Now remember, they said, how is this possible? And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. What more of an answer do you need? Have faith in God. Jesus explains in verse 23, for assuredly I say unto you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he will say will be done, he will have whatever he says. Jesus presents them with a lesson about the power behind faith, indicating that with faith, they could wither the tree themselves. That's something that we must learn. The power of our faith gives us the ability to have control over our situations. With faith in God and without doubting, they could have power to tell a mountain, take a jump into the sea, and the mountain would do it. Imagine that. If you were to walk out right now and look at Mount Charleston and go, you, I don't like you, go to California and jump in the sea. And all of a sudden, Mount Charleston's gone. That, if you had the faith without doubt, would happen, is what he's saying. Now, this is figurative. Now, I'm going to explain. Let me be clear about this. This is not a name it and claim it moment. Not at all. As a matter of fact, a lot of pastors, people that like to preach their own word instead of God's word, will take this and they will twist it. But this is not a name it and claim it moment. We're not talking about God granting wishes or giving you everything that you pray for. That's not what happens. Jesus promises that the disciples' demands will be met if they have the appropriate faith. When it speaks about whoever does not doubt, now this is important. The word used for doubt is the same word that James uses when he wrote in James 1:6, saying, but let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. Faith, this is important, faith is knowing that God will. Not thinking God will, but knowing that God will. Not thinking that God can, but knowing that he can and does. It's not about, oh, I have faith the Lord could kind of help me out in this situation if I'm lucky. No, it's knowing that God can help us out in any situation. And it has nothing to do with luck. This is not an open-ended promise, though. We're not talking about, well, if I have the faith, especially because there are charlatans out there that say, I have enough faith that I could heal people. Baloney. That's not what we're talking about either. This is not an open-ended promise. There are conditions that are placed, expectations that are attached. We must ask for what is in God's will. That is the first thing that we must remember. It's not about what we want. It's not about how we think things should be. The only way that our faith is truly effective is when we petition the Lord for what's in his will. In 1 John 5:14 and 15, it tells us, now this is the confidence that we have in him, being God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, We know that we have the petitions that we have asked for him, of him. Again, if it's in God's will to do something and we ask him, he will do it. But it must be in God's will. Whatever we ask for to be done has to be something that is in line with God's plan. Which brings me to another condition. And that is, we cannot ask for what is in God's will if we do not know what God's will is. So how do we know what God's will is for us? And that answer is that the only way to find out what's in God's will for us is we must abide in Jesus Christ. We must know God's will through knowing Jesus. Jesus said in John 15:7, if you abide in me and my word abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done for you. Now notice it says done for you, not given to you. We're not talking about material things. It says it will be done for you. If we are following Christ and we are living for Christ, being crucified with Christ, then our desires should match the desires of Jesus Christ. Not our own worldly wants. Not our own worldly and bodily feelings. What we desire should only be that which Jesus desires, making it acceptable for God to answer our prayers. Because if it's what Jesus desires, then it's what God desires, because God is Jesus. Jesus is God. It's also important that when we pray, we have the appropriate reasons. If we ask God to provide us with things that will give us worldly comfort and worldly pleasure, we are headed towards conflict with God, because God has nothing to do with worldly pleasure. He is not going to grant us wishes of a new Mercedes-Benz and a bank account like Donald Trump. It's not going to happen. Verse 24 tells us, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them. The point, of course, isn't that Jesus wants us to start looking at mountains and trying to will them into the sea. He wants the disciples to understand that in him and through him, they will have the power beyond themselves to accomplish the tasks that he is going to give them in the future. Again, let me explain this, just in case you might have missed it. When we are in Jesus, when Jesus is in us, we have a power and an ability that is beyond ourselves, that we can ask God for help and he will listen. It's not of our own doing. It's God's doing. Christ specifically tells the disciples they will receive anything they ask, but only if they have faith. This meant that they had to trust in God and his power to do what they needed to do, because it was his will. Asking in faith through prayer means trusting God to do what is most fitting for the betterment of everyone, with his purpose in mind, not the world's purpose. We can always be confident of God's power as well as his goodness to do what is right, always. There's never going to be a time where we will pray for something bad to happen, because God does not deal in evil. Finally, we know through reading Scripture, without faith, we have nothing. In Hebrews 11:6, it tells us, but without faith, it is impossible to please him, him being God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. That means that if we truly wish to speak to the Lord, then we faithfully hit our knees and pray to him. We faithfully worship him. We faithfully thank him for the things in our lives, because it is he who provides for us. Jesus' message to the disciples that day, as well as to every believer who has read the account since, consists of one message, and that message is consistent with what he's taught through his entire ministry that we have read and that we will continue to read. It is through faith that we are saved. It is through faith we can be healed. When Jesus said to certain people in the Bible, "Your faith has made you well," or "Your faith has made you whole," he is saying their faith, meaning their confidence in Jesus, their confidence in God doing what he says he will do, had been the means for their renewal. The change in their life, the healing came from their faith that God will do what he said he will do. As followers of Christ, we are to believe that nothing is impossible for God. We do not limit God's power. And therefore, we can also trust that what he has promised throughout the entire Bible will certainly be done, even though it seems impossible for us to believe. We can move mountains in our lives. We could face Goliaths in our lives, meaning we can overcome the greatest struggles that we ever face. When things are done by faith, when we put our trust in God, faith that acts upon the Word of God is the same faith that saves us. It's the same faith that can heal us. And it is the same faith that guides us in how we should be. If there is anything that I hope that you hear today, anything that you take with you today, I hope that is this. Jesus taught that we need to pray with faith. And we are to have complete faith in God. I'm going to ask Brother Bill to join me. I want you to take this moment, this time that we have to reflect. I want you to bow your head in faith and pray to the Lord and thank him for the trials and the tribulations that you learn and you grow from. Thank him for the blessings of the people in our lives. And if you have a concern, if you have something weighing you down, now is the time to bring that to God and leave it with him. And I want to encourage you, if you are watching this, if you are here and you're listening, and you do not yet know the faith that it takes for salvation, let today be the day that you show your trust in the Lord. Accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior.
Oh, thank you, Pastor. We need to remember faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Oh, thank you, Father. Let us pray. Gracious Father, this being your day that you've given us, thank you for this message on faith, and that praying, Lord, and asking, as long as we ask in accordance to your will, you will hear us and answer us. And just thank you again, Lord, that we are still able to come and worship you in song and hear your word from our pastor. Be with us now, Lord, as we go forth. Bless us during this week and let us all come back next week, Lord, that we can gather in your name. In Jesus' name, amen.